Believe it or not, PDFs are actually the second most common malware delivery method, basically, that exists in things like email attacks. It accounts for something like 22% of all malicious attachments, according to April 2025 data from Checkpoint, that is. Now, imagine the contract from your lawyer or that invoice from a vendor that you got, the research paper that you got from a colleague. Basically, any of them could contain JavaScript exploits, things like credential harvesting links or malware loaders that are hidden in compromised streams. Adobe Acrobat alone has like 91 documented vulnerabilities. And 3 days ago, a new toolkit hit the market called Matrix PDF, which basically appeared out of nowhere on things like cybercrime forums. And basically what it lets you do is kind of weaponize clean PDFs with things like blurred overlays and fake security buttons, which obviously bypasses things like Gmail filters completely. Opening documents from untrusted sources really gambles your entire system. Freedom of the Press Foundation, which is incredibly badass. If you go there and you look at like their board of directors, you'll kind of see why. But they basically came up with this solution that converts things like hostile documents with malware in them into safe PDFs through hyper-aggressive isolation. And it works by basically destroying everything except the pixels that the document's made of. The tool is called DangerZone, and it takes files from sources that you can't verify and basically runs them through like these three layers of sandboxing before you ever see the actual content. Now, in this video, we will install this and we'll run it so you can actually see what I'm talking about. So what you do is you basically drop any kind of PDF, suspicious or whatever, into the application, and it spins up a Docker container on Mac, Windows, or Linux. It works in them all. The document processing actually happens completely isolated from your actual operating system with networking disabled and your file system completely unmounted. Malicious code that executes inside of that sandbox can't really reach your kernel. They can't access your files or communicate with any command and control servers. The actual conversion process treats every document as hostile. DangerZone actually renders each page as raw RGB pixel data, literally just color values for every point on every page. Like JavaScript basically dies in the actual conversion. So things like embedded executables obviously vanish with that. Also though, things like tracking beacons disappear. Macros cease to exist, right? So the software takes this kind of pixel stream that it creates and then reconstructs it into a compressed PDF outside of the sandbox, right? So you also have things like optional OCR through PyMuPDF, which adds things like searchable text back, but that happens after the sanitization process is actually done using the clean pixel data rather than the original document structure. Now, first thing that comes to mind is, how do we know this is safe? And for one, you should never trust any software. Even when you can look at the source, you shouldn't trust it. That's a whole other topic, though. But there's a company called Include Security, which did a independent audit on this tool for like 12 days in 2023, I think December 2023. And they basically found no critical vulnerabilities whatsoever. They found no high-risk issues and zero medium-risk issues. They did find three low-risk findings, which basically popped up around container update frequency. It's kind of like a whatever. The audit basically covered exploratory testing, manual code review, and dynamic analysis, as well as like stuff like architecture and assessment and sandbox configuration review. So security software designed to protect journalists from state-level adversaries basically passed this independent security audit without any major red flags popping up. Journalists represent kind of the obvious use case here. a whistleblower inside a defense contractor sends a, procurement of like found evidence through secure drop. That PDF could contain like legitimate documents or an exploit chain designed to try to compromise the mailroom and identify the source. Opening it directly risks both the story and the source's safety. DangerZone completely removes that risk through that kind of technical isolation rather than just blind trust. Now, the guy that originally built the tool at First Look Media was inspired by Cube's OS in regards to like trusted PDF functionality. Freedom of the Press Foundation took over development in 2022. This is, again, the same organization that was basically running SecureDrop, which is the encrypted submission platform that major newsrooms actually depend on worldwide. So the threat model actually extends way beyond journalism, though. Activists receive leaked government documents from sympathetic insiders, defense attorneys, get discovery materials from prosecutors with kind of questionable operational security practices. Researchers handle papers from colleagues in places like surveillance states, right? Human rights workers process asylum documentation from refugees. Basically, anyone receiving documents from partially trusted sources basically needs sanitization capabilities. Edward Snowden and Laura Poitras sit on the Freedom of the Press Foundation's board of directors. That's what I meant earlier when I was saying basically badasses. The association alone kind of lets you know who you're dealing with, right? The integration of things like virtualization, for example, adds like really, really important protection against stuff like kernel exploits. And regular containers share the host kernel, creating escape routes if attackers find things like kernel vulnerabilities. Now, this implements a userspace kernel, intercepting system calls before they actually reach Linux. Now, malicious code needs to actually escape the document sandbox, then escape the Gvisor, then escape the container, then reach your actual host system. Like multiple boundaries requiring separate exploits at each layer. Tails explicitly recommends DangerZone, but can't bundle it by default because the software requires like 1 gigabyte of storage. So the Debian-based privacy operating system that activists, for one, boot from USB drives really considers this tool as essential, but obviously it's just too big. Hardware requirements also match the threat model, at least 8 gigabytes of RAM for actual installation and substantial memory during the first run, enough storage for container images. And those kind of requirements really filter for serious threat environments kind of rather than the casual use. The software costs absolutely nothing, and the Freedom of the Press Foundation released it under the AGPL V3 license with source code on GitHub. No commercial surveillance company extracts monthly subscriptions. There's absolutely no nonsensical cloud service or process that you have to pay for on remote servers. Everything runs locally in containers that get destroyed after each conversion, leaving obviously zero persistent state data between those operations. The alternative involves trusting PDF readers to handle hostile documents safely, which is absolutely insane. Adobe patches vulnerabilities after public disclosure. Browser vendors, for example, also update rendering engines on schedules. So it's a roll of the dice. Like users basically install updates when it's good for them rather than immediately. And that gap between disclosure and deployment kind of creates an exploitation window that is fairly serious, right? So with this, it kind of stops attackers dead in their tracks. DangerZone eliminates that window by assuming every document contains exploits and essentially destroying them through pixel conversion like a teleporter. And some institutions actually block the tool precisely because it works. So like corporate IT, for example, they do monitoring for like document exchanges for things like data loss prevention. They can't inspect sanitized output because the metadata vanishes, and government agencies tracking document lineage through embedded identities lose that capability when everything becomes pixels, right? So the feature really protects privacy that threatens kind of like that institutional control. So like a lot of institutions don't let it, a lot of institutions don't allow it. The trade-off becomes an obvious one once you really understand converting documents to pixels destroys those kind of interactive features. It does things like strip metadata, breaks digital signatures, and adds processing time. And those costs by isolation from exploitation, from surveillance, and from compromise too. So receiving occasional PDFs from colleagues in safe jurisdictions probably doesn't really justify the overhead in that case, but processing documents from sources facing arrest or from adversaries wanting to try to compromise your system absolutely requires sanitization. So most real-world document exchanges absolutely fail somewhere between those extremes where trust exists, but verification really remains prudent. And your threat model obviously determines whether this actually makes sense. Like, what would losing a document and its security actually cost you? Answer that question, and you kind of know whether DangerZone belongs in your workflow or if it doesn't. With that in mind, let's actually go ahead and install it and then run it. Okay, so we're going to start off. This is the, obviously, the GitHub. And this is their, like, official website. And you can see right here, there's a ton of different OSs. We're going with Ubuntu Debian. This is generic, and Debian's awesome. And we'll start off with updating and installing the certificates and GPG. Then we're going to make a directory. And now we will import the DangerZone release key into the apt keyring. And so long syntax. I take a minute. All right, boom, there we go. And now we're going to go ahead and set the correct permissions on the actual keyring file. And let's add the DangerZone repo for Ubuntu Noble. Now we're going to remove the broken XIA repo entries that actually caused errors that I had before. And then we'll update. And then once that's done, we're going to go ahead and actually install it. And that's as simple as sudo apt install minus -y DangerZone. Now, I sped this up a little bit so it doesn't take forever, but you'll kind of see it downloads a lot of stuff. This is not a small application by any means. I'll go back up here and you'll see that my search engine is a local IP. Yeah, that's awesome, isn't it? We'll get into that in a future video. And not today, though. I'm going to look for just a random PDF. Why not look for the Art of War, right? It has some relevance here. We'll grab it. Download. Save. Boom. And now we're going to run it. We can run it from the command line or the GUI. We'll pull up the GUI, and we see like it'll pop up installing the DangerZone container image. This may take a few minutes. Wait a little bit. Now, if you run it from the CLI, it's just going to open the GUI. That's how it works. But who cares? Because the CLI is always better. So we'll type DangerZone and then help to see what the options are. And it's not going to show us because it's like two options. So we'll go ahead and run a DangerZone, and we'll just put the file name. And we see that it has not downloaded yet. So we'll go back up. Keep. You can tell, see, the PDFs are dangerous. And it's like, I don't want to download it. Okay, so now we have it. So now it'll be DangerZone, then the PDF name. And we'll see it pop up. Boom, there it is. And you can see we have options here that include the OCR, which is what we talked about before. We're going to save it to a different directory, desktop. And once you got everything you want, go ahead and click convert safe document. And we see it spinning up. You see Podman spun up because we're in Linux. Now this is sped up considerably, I think 15 times. So, I mean, there's that. It's like a four core. So it's not a very powerful computer anyways, but that's it. Like you can see here, it spat it out. That's it. And the other thing to keep in mind is with this tool, like this does way more than just PDFs. Does pictures, does all kinds of stuff. So it's actually incredibly useful. Let me know what you think about this tool in the comments. In any case, thank you for watching. I'll see you in the next video.